Praise the Lord. We want to extend our condolences as from the ministry to the Frasers family and ask God's grace and blessings upon each and every one of you, friends and well wishers. We ask God's grace and blessings upon each and every one of your lives. Amen. We pray that as we begin this service today, that we will have the strength not only of the Lord, but from the Lord, in order to go through and to deal with this loss. We want to ask everyone to please stand as we begin our service with our familiar hymn, How Great Thou Art. And right after that, we're going to have an opening prayer by Pastor Charles. And we want to ask God's blessing in Jesus' name. Praise God. How great thou art. O Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the world thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displaying. Amen. O Lord my God, when I'm in awesome, consider all.
Thy word thy hands have made. I see the stars. I hear the rolling thunder. Thy power throughout the universe display. Then sings my soul. My Savior, go to thee. How great thou art. How great thou art. Then sings my soul. My Savior, go to thee. How great thou art. God, His Son, not sparing, say,
Hallelujah.
Bless the Lord.
Praise the name of
Hallelujah.
Jesus.
We
Hallelujah.
Give praise this
we give
morning.
God praise. We
you
give
are
him
worthy,
all the
Lord.
Honor.
Hallelujah.
We give him all of
we
the glory.
We exalt your name this
How
morning.
How great you are, Jesus.
You are worthy, Jesus.
You are great, Father, and you are
awesome,
greatly
Lord.
To
Hallelujah.
Be praised. Hallelujah. And praise so, Father Jesus. And God, today, oh God, we give you all the praise. We give you all the honor.
Yes,
we give you all of the glory.
Hallelujah.
And Father, even as we came today to celebrate the life of our brother, oh God, we commit everything in
yes,
your
Lord,
hands.
Yes, Lord.
And Father, even as your word said, blessed are they that mourn, so
for
they shall be comforted.
Yes, Lord.
We thank you, oh God, because you are the God of comfort. We thank you, oh God, today because you are a friend that sticketh closer than a brother. And even now today, oh God,
yes, Lord,
we ask, oh God, for your divine presence.
Yes,
we ask, oh God, that you would cover the bereaved family, his wife, his children, his extended family,
yes,
friends and well-wishers. We ask, oh God, that you would cover them under your almighty blood. Daddy, today, oh God, we pray, oh God, for your grace. And we pray, oh God, for your strength in no other name but in Jesus' holy and matchless name with thanksgiving. Amen.
Amen.
And amen.
Praise the Lord. You may have your seat. We want to ask that the young man who's holding the door open there, could you please keep it closed so that the... Yes, thank you. Praise the Lord. At this point in time, we have a eulogy. It's going to be read by Brother Fraser's children and also Sister Hillary, is it? All right, we're going to give room for them at this time, please.
Good morning, everyone. Good morning, everyone. Thank you for taking the time to be here with us today as we celebrate the life of our dad, and for some, a business partner, friend, family member, and loved one. So here before you with me is Lisa, Daddy's eldest, Lorely, Daddy's youngest, me, Makisha, Daddy's middle child, and LaShawn is also here with us, Daddy's other daughter. When you attend funerals of friends and their loved ones, you often reflect on what may be said if and when you are to be placed in the same position and having to take this podium. You reflect, if only briefly, what you may want persons to know about your loved one. And in our case, a man who lived for 69 years and someone we knew our entire lifetime in just a few minutes. For us, it would be the things that were most impressionable and undoubtedly his legacy. Today, we want to celebrate that legacy and the life of our father, Rudolph Davidson Fraser. Please allow us to share this journey.
Daddy was a simple man who loved simple things which were dear to his heart. His parents, Ma Lucy and Terrell Bullen, both deceased, who he defended with his life and loved beyond words. Nicole, or as we call her, Nick, his beloved and devoted wife. His children, who each believed they were truly his favorite. In that voice, his darling sweetheart sister, Auntie Hillary, and with whom he spoke almost daily, as well as Uncle John, Kadeem, Kimon, and his sunshine, Kayla. His paint shop, which was the blood that ran in his veins. Music, which made him alive, loving every genre and sharing his love with all. Grenada, his motherland and full of fond memories with the Bullen and Fraser families. Morris Miners and Station Wagons, of course his cars, synonymous with his business, always well detailed and painted. And most importantly, family and quality time.
Rudolph was born in Grenada, and at the young age of 11, made his way over to Trinidad to meet his mother in a quest for a better life. They settled in Trumacac and then Mento Ali, Lavantil, where he spent most of his teenage and adult life. Perhaps a well-kept secret of our father was that he DJ'd. His alias was DJ Rudy. And he played at many social gatherings, including weddings and parties. He made his own speakers, which towered over him and always had a dedicated music room full of mixing boards and other DJ equipment. His special care routine was evident, as he would first clean his CDs with a manual CD cleaner and spray. There was no other way to do it. He often used his music and DJing as a babysitting technique for young Lishon and me. On Sundays,
he was sure to wake up the entire neighborhood, starting with the usual Jim Reeves classics, and he just played for the joy of entertainment. Over to his professional life. He acquired the vocational skills of plumbing and briefly worked as a plumber. He was then employed as a paint technician and eventually manager in the late 70s at Sherwin Williams, say 1979 to 82, where he skillfully acquired the art of mixing paint and applications. Well sought after by the paint distributors, and upon the realization that the auto paint business was his passion, he took up the offer to manage an auto paint store of his own in Chaguanas. Noting the vibrant used car market, Dad, along with two others, Gilbert Thomas and Mr. Anthony Lewis, his dear friend, established the auto paint shop called J-Fab Company Limited in 1983. In time, Dad would briefly establish a branch in Curep, whilst his main operations remained in El Socorro Road, San Juan, as it is today.
Hard work was in Dad's DNA, and he loved commerce, making some of us fall in love with it too. He devoted over 42 years of his life to same and remained a dominant player in the sale and distribution of automotive paints and paint supplies. His work ethic was self-motivated and driven by the need to succeed for his family. One example is that he'd do anything for his clients, delivering orders in places people may not fathom to go. There wasn't a place that was a boundary for our dad. His urgency in making his clients happy was always his priority. and Sunday to Sunday, inclusive of holidays, I mean. Dad was definitely a workhorse, and his personal brand was reflected in the long-standing relationships he developed with many clients and suppliers over the years. A fond memory I have is that Dad engages all his children in the world of mix and paint, teaching some of us a bit of the ropes in color matching using eyesight only. And this was prior to the introduction of barcodes and paint formulas. For the older ones, he was our first employer and didn't spoil us because we were his children. On Saturdays, we were required to be at the shop promptly at 8 o'clock, whether or not I was required to bring his favorite punch from the Quasi. We remember Dad having paint boards dripped paint, which were deemed artistic pieces and well sought after by clients. Mind you, Nicole worked with Dad for a number of years. It's just about over 25 years. And she would have acquired the skill set to run the business now. I guess they took when two becomes one, literally.
Okay. As we journey into his personal life, we all know that Dad's charm and winning smile was like no other. He melted the hearts of many, and it afforded him the opportunity to meet some great women in his life. Our mothers, of course. Dad courted my mom, Janice, and had his firstborn, me. After some time, he then entered his first marriage with Auntie Joanne and had his one son, Rennie, and Makisha. Sometime after that, he remarried and moved to Twin City with Auntie Jenny, where LaShawn and Laurie was born. Dad's charisma and persistence didn't allow him to stop there. He eventually captured the heart of his beloved Nicole, whom he married in 2011, and with her, he spent the rest of his life. They had a really loving marriage, full of talks and back chats. And we all fostered a very special bond with Nicole's daughter, Charlene, who's here with us today, and granddaughter, Kayla. Okay, a fond memory. His kids were in three different areas in the country. And so we spent many times traversing the highways to visit each other, going on adventures such as San Fernando Hills, eating boil and roast corn, and having ice cream, of course. The Churchill Roosevelt Highway was a perfect place to initiate the lifelong lessons, anticipating our challenges in life ahead. Go, Daddy, go. Yes, the highways were great for impressing us kids. If he felt life's making a great impression to everyone else on the road, he'd pick us up in the red Morris Minor, PK2350.
Well, for LaShawn and me, the younger kids, our preference was for the station wagon. At the time, the Morris Minor, or what we used to call the red car, was a source of misery. The first question we would always ask was, Daddy, which car are you using? We had to mentally prepare ourselves for this bright red buggy ride. We used to lay with our heads down in the back seat so that none of our friends in school would see us. Daddy would always say, sit up, sit up. Sometimes even popping the horn to draw attention to the car. Of course, we wouldn't listen and wait till the coast was clear before we sat up again. No matter what, he impressed upon us the meaning of staying together and being proud of what we have, regardless of growing up in different homes.
Dad's love for family was great. Gatherings on special occasions and weekend visits were absolutely necessary to avoid a buff from him. You see, Quality time was his main love language, and he took offense to it if you didn't carve out enough time to spend with him. His phone bills evidenced his focus on staying in touch with many siblings, cousins, and friends that resided abroad that he spoke to on a daily and sometimes weekly basis. If you ever traveled, he'd be sure to remind you of family who was living in an area near to where you were staying. By the time you acknowledged him, you were already receiving contact from that same family member, knowing that he already reached out to them. Dad's love for his extended family, whether it be in Trinidad, Grenada, or any other continent, was evident. Basically, wherever he was located, or wherever they were located, rather, he was a family crusader.
As we come to the end of our remembrance of Dad, we want to mention especially Auntie Stephanie, Uncle Kenny, Uncle Tony, the Tanners, Sister Joanne, Pastor Charles, Dexter and Chris. Dad had a great regards for all of you. To name a few of Nicole's family and neighbors, you all were there in a heartbeat throughout his trying times. To everyone, your love, prayers, and overall support is invaluable to us. To the close friends, family, and well-wishers of our family, Father, your many calls and words of encouragement meant a lot to him and to us as well. Dad had a colorful life and career. His legacy was about doing the right thing in life, and if it proved difficult, he believed in working twice as hard to get you where you needed to go. Daddy, you will always cherish these and so many other memories of you, the good, the bad, and the ugly, as only God can be perfect. There is no certainty that we can handle all the challenges that you have faced within your life and overcame the way you did with God's grace. We are sorry that you couldn't stick around a little longer to meet the new additions to the family. We love you and know that you are no longer suffering. We pray you are at peace wherever you are and that your memories will live on.
We will now share with you a poem. God saw you getting tired, and the cure was not to be. So he put his arms around you and whispered, "Come to me." With tearful eyes, we watched you suffer and saw you fade away. Although we loved you dearly, we could not make you stay. A golden heart stopped beating. Hard-working hands laid to rest. God broke our hearts to prove he only takes the best.
A very good friend of mine once told me, or rather reminded me of the words of the late Bob Marley. Some people are so poor, all they have is money. But not our dad, he was wealthy. Rest in peace, Dad.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Hillary, Rudolph's only sibling on his maternal side. As kids, Rudy and I were very close. But the time came when we had to be separated, when he had to leave Grenada for Trinidad. A couple days before he left, he gave me a bag of marbles. They were all the marbles he had collected from winning marble games. Those of you who are my age and over would know what marble games are and how important those, he had a chess, yeah. And he was really good. Yeah, he had a big chest of marbles. And they were precious to him. Yet he gave them all to me, his little sister. That was the beginning of an everlasting bond between us. Stretching from wherever I was in the world to his heart in Trinidad. That brother-sister relationship never ended, and it never will. There is a saying that death ends the time frame of a life, but it never ends relationships. I share this personal memory with you so that you would understand what a loving, giving person my brother was. He would give all he had to help others, thus building bonds of friendship within his family, in his community, and the world over. His giving spirit, his kind-heartedness, and his great sense of humor sustained his relationship with others. Those of you who knew him would agree with me that he was a simple man, jovial, fun-loving, and witty. He was as strong as an ox when it came to hard work, yet he could be as stubborn as a mule. He would fight like a bull for what he believed in, and he would cry like a baby when touched or overwhelmed with goodness. His family meant the world to him. Right now, we can imagine him looking down and smiling at us with a twinkle in his eye and telling us with a chuckle to remember him. He says this through a poem that I'm going to read to you, one by a poet, Margaret Mead. There he is looking down, and he's telling us, "To the living, I am gone. To the sorrowful, I will never return. To the happy, I am at peace. And to the faithful, I have never left. I cannot speak, but I can listen. So be careful what you say. I cannot be seen, but I can be heard. So listen. As you stand upon a shore gazing at a beautiful sea, as you stand and look upon a flower and admire its simplicity, remember me. Remember me in your heart, your thoughts, and your memories of the times we loved, the times we cried, the times we fought, and the times we loved. For if you always think of me, I will never be gone. So remember me. We will remember you, brother. We will."
Thank you so much. Is it all right if we put our hands together? Is it all right? We're going to have a tribute by Kenny Fraser. And it's going to come at this point in time. not here. All right. All right.
Praise God.
So what we want to do at this time is that we're going to... Okay, so there's going to be a tribute by Usman at this time. He's going to come. Right after that, we want to open the floor for at least two or three testimonies, tributes to this great man.
Morning, everyone. Well, I felt I've been put on the spot here. I didn't have anything prepared. My name is Osman Ghani. I represent AP Scott Trinidad Limited. We have been business partners with Mr. Fraser for a very long time. My relationship with Mr. Fraser started 22 years ago. A good friend and colleague, Mr. Jaira Caesar, at the back, recommended that I spend some time with Mr. Fraser before choosing my career. Every day I would show up, like his daughter said, you have to be there on time, 8 o'clock in the morning. He's a stickler for time. And he taught me the ropes. Just like his children said, we're going off into the battlefield in Laventil, East Port of Spain, to drop his orders. His orders were very important to him. After spending a few weeks with him, close to 2 months, I decided, look, this is going to be my career, my passion. And I've been doing that since then. Mr. Fraser is a very dear friend to me. There were times that I would down, and like his children said again, that he will give his last to see that you get through. He, a witty person, a very loving person, and he will surely be missed. I will really, really miss Mr. Fraser. Thankful that Nicole is still going to be here with us and doing the business. And I can only see that the business will go on with his memory and love. So thank you very much.
I think I see Mr. Kenny just walked in. And asked him to come at this time. It's a longtime friend. And cousin. Brother, yeah, Brother Fraser, used to call him his brother. Praise God.
Good morning. Morning, everyone. I much apologize to be late because of the traffic coming from the east. So I'll start, I believe I have 5 minutes or less. Less than 5 minutes. Okay, I'll try to wrap up as quickly as possible. All right, here lies the body of my cousin, friend, brother, Rudolph Fraser. May the saints take him into eternity and may you rest in peace. Now, I know Rudy in the mid-60s when he came from Grenada, and he was my aunt, which is Auntie Lucy, take him to a private school in Belmont, which is Ideal. From Ideal, he went to Trinidad Plumbing, which he started there. And then he went on to Charles Nichols. And from Charles Nichols, he went to Sherwin Williams. And then three of his good friends or comrades, they went into business. And they coined the name JFAB. And people wonder how this name was formed. It was Junior who migrated to the United States, and Tony who went on. He got a big offer, so he went on to do better. And F for Frase, which was Rudolph Frase. He was then asked to take over the business, and he bought out the shares. And one day he called me, he said, cousin boy, I need some help, you know. I said, what help you need? He said, boy, the business is mine now, you know. And I had to do articles of association. You know a lawyer? I say yes. And one of my friends or comrade too, when I attend Cipriani Labor College, we get in touch with him. And he draft, I think it was JFAB 1995, correct? 89, right. And that's where he continued as a young businessman, entrepreneur. I can remember, even as listening coming down, he worked from east, west, north, and south of Trinidad and Tobago, servicing garages. And I used to call him the doctor of mixing paint, because he developed an instinct that he will take the paint to the car and, you know, he checked to see the color, and he said, a tip of red, a tip of blue, a tip of black, you know, and the mix come in. So, you know, he was a genius. He will be missed by all. I know he was a brother, family man. He loved his family. He loved sports, take part in different sporting activities. He also joined the Boy Scout movement, which was, I believe, was 7 Trinidad. He was also a member of the Scout band. And also, he joined Rotaract Club of Port of Spain, which many of us know as the Rotary Club, juniors. And one of the things he loved was to work with children. And he worked with the junior achievers, helping them to achieve their goals in business. And he was director in the club at that time. He was community director, and you know, it was a lot of challenges, you know, working with young people, but eventually we got through. And some of the members of Junior Achievers joined Rotaract, some move on to university and went on joining the workplace. I believe my 5 minutes is left. You gotta check me, you know. Oh, I have one more minute again. Right. Yes, so I will say my cousin, he was a disciplinarian. And, you know, my cousin said he loved crying. Everybody loved to cry. I cried recently of passing of my wife. And they called me, he was crying, say, Kenny, I want your help, you know. I said, what? He said, I want you to discipline the troops. He said, they're fighting me, you know. I said, what do you mean? He said, I want you to come and talk to them. And, you know, went to speak to them. And all in all, everything went back to normal. And we had a very loving time after. And the family stayed together. What I like to say is, the songwriter said that he did it his way. I believe Rudolph, this is his way he did it in life. He was, as one of his daughters mentioned that he was a workaholic. He worked 7 days a week. But if you add that up by OSHA, he worked 48 hours. The working hours a week is 40. If you look at Saturday and Sunday, half day, that's 4 and 4, that's 48 hours. So, and that's to keep his family, and he said, boy, I have to pay my bills, you know. He said, you working for somebody, but I have to pay my bills. And this is when a businessman who is by himself and have to struggle, you have nobody by your side, you know. And there's few people you could call, you know, for comfort. But I will say he did it his way, and we must keep him in memory for the good things, the positive things he left with us. Thank you very much.
Praise the Lord. We leave the floor open for at least 2 tributes by anyone. And your time is not 5 minutes. It's a little less than 5 minutes now. So if you're coming, you're going to have to make it short. All right, it's a request by the family. If you're here, would you like to come and make a tribute? Please come now.
Good morning, brothers and sisters in Christ. Lisa, who is one of his daughters, is my niece. Her mother is my sister, and I have another sister here with me. I have known Rudolph from the time my niece Lisa, who is also like a daughter to me, from birth. And all that was said about him this morning is truth. He was really a family person. And although I did not visit him at the hospital because I had eye surgery, I kept in touch with my niece every day to find out how her dad was going. And the other sisters, I must say that I know all of them, and everybody is auntie. So, I am very happy on behalf of the Taylors, the Pereiras, the Ordains, and the Melville family to pray our dear brother this morning. Rudolph, what I want to say to you, because we always keep in touch, and the family that prays together stays together, I want to say to you, Rudolph, good night, but not goodbye.
Pleasant morning to one and all in the house, God House, this morning. My name is Gregory Richard Figaro. I have known Mr. Frase for over 30 years. I knew him since the days of the show in Williams time. Friend and a customer of his thing, because I do body work like that. So always accommodating guy, loving, kind. And he accommodates so many of us. I don't see much of us here today who had access to his service at his paint shop, but I know Mr. Frase was always a generous man to us. To have many times, all of us in business, we struggle. Sometimes we don't have enough money to purchase this stuff. But you could go to Mr. Frase and say, Mr. Frase, X, Y, Z, and he had your back. I want to thank God for him and his family. I want to say, Nicole, God bless, continue to be strengthened in this time, and to his family. I want to say your dad was extremely a good man.
That was good. That was quick and that was fast. So let me just, for a few minutes of your time, share with you from the scriptures. And from the Word of God in the book of 1 Corinthians, chapter number 15. And I'm reading from verse 51. The Bible says, "Behold, I show you a mystery. For we shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed in a moment, in the twinkle of an eye, at the last trump. For the trumpet shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. For this corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put on immortality. And so when this corruptible shall have put on incorruption, and this mortal shall have put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? The sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, which giveth us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, my beloved brethren, be steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord. For as much as you know that your labor is not in vain in the Lord." I sat there this morning, and for those of you who probably came in afterwards, I do extend my condolences to the family, the Frasers, and all of the extended families, especially to the wife, his wife, Sister Nicole. Strong woman. I have a thing I like to say, that when I meet people like her, they are made out of aloe zinc. But I know it is the strength of the Lord. It can't be anything else. I said to my wife also has Grenadian background, so I said, "Use one of them aloe zinc people. She don't get sick, she don't get, you know, she go in the fridge 3 o'clock in the morning, she don't get no cold. If I pass by the fridge, I just get cold." You know, so there's a different breed of individuals. But we thank God, we know that God is her strength. I remember meeting Brother Fraser maybe about 15 years ago or so. And he asked me what my name was. I told him, "Well, I'm David." He said, "I'm David too." And, you know, he made a joke about it. As somebody said a while ago, he's always making jokes. And so he's very jovial. He's a person that he's very, very nice to be around. You know, when we think about it, the old die, the young die, leaders and followers die, business people die. It doesn't matter what strata of life you are on, what is your background, what is your education, every single type of individuals die. And sometimes we sit back and we say that, you know, this person has too much going for them. That doesn't matter. Life is of such that all men are going to die. The writer to the Corinthians did not just refer to death as we know it, in his grim, empty, heart-aching way, but he makes mention of a mystery that is at work, where some of us will not go by way of the grave, but he indicates that we will be changed at some point in time. He says, "We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. We shall not all have need of a place in the ground, but when God comes and he calls us, we shall be changed in a moment, in the twinkle of an eye." When we are changed by the presence of God and God comes and he calls us, it doesn't matter where you are, you will answer that call. Because death will not be able to hold you down. Grave will not be able to hold you down. The writer to the Corinthians was giving hope to all of us, to all and sundry. And he's saying to us that if you live for the Lord, When he comes, you will be changed. You will be called forth. Amen, somebody. And then he answers it. He said, how would you be changed? He said, in a moment, in the twinkle of an eye, change will come. We'll be translated from this body of death into a body of life. The change will be quick. It will be sudden. The letter to the Corinthians was to settle the issue of the resurrection, whether or not when a man dies, you know, we have the saying that when we're dead, we're done. But the writer in the scriptures does not support that view. He tells us that we shall be changed. We will be changed in the moment, in the twinkle of an eye. This letter to the Corinthians was, as I said, to settle the issue of resurrection, whether or not we will be coming back again. To some people, when you live this life and you die, that's the end of it. You eat, drink, and just be merry, because that's the end of it. But we have learned different from the scriptures, that when we die, it's not the end. We will come back again. We will be resurrected on that day. And that's what Brother Frase understood. Having been baptized, I remember when we were baptizing him, he was jolly, he was happy that he made this decision. And I can tell you that the scripture says heaven rejoices when one soul comes home. When one person makes that decision, the writer informs us that we shall be changed. Even in verse 8, he says God will give us a body that pleases him. Because oftentimes we tell ourselves, you know, when mommy died, that's it. When daddy dies, he's going on. We're not going to see him anymore. But if you live God's people's life, you will die God's people's death. And so as believers in Christ, we live with this hope that we will see again. I always tell people, if you miss daddy enough, then you should live how he lived, so that you can go where he has gone. We live with a life that is filled with hope, that our change is coming at some point in time. Whether we go by the way of the grave or we are changed that is coming, we will all be changed. Revelation 14 and 13 says, I have heard a voice from heaven saying unto me, write, blessed are the dead which die in the Lord from henceforth. Yea, says the Spirit, that they may rest from their labors and their works do follow them. The reality is that everything that we do in this life, we will have to answer for it. You're not going to get away. We're going to have to stand before the Lord. Somebody who's brighter than what the writers in the scripture are, brighter than God. They said that, you know, heaven and hell right here. What you know, everything you're paying for here, and you will live your heaven here, and you will die in hell here. The fact of the matter is that we are going to stand before a living God. And we are going to have to answer. The victory of dying in Christ is when we live in Christ. And our brother, Brother Frase, we can stand this morning and not have to make up any stories. Oh, he was a good man. He lived good for the Lord. And all the time we say, my pastor could realize. You ever been anywhere, people speaking so well about somebody and you know that's not the individual? But everything we heard this morning, as Mommy came up and said a while ago, is true. That we don't have to make up any stories about Brother Frase. We know the life that he lived. We know how he went about his business. Amen. When we live for Christ, we will die for Christ. Our works will follow us. Everything we have done in this life, we will have to give an answer to the Lord for it. In the book of 1 John 3 and 2, it says, Beloved, now are we the sons of God, and do it not yet appear what we shall be, but we know that when he shall appear, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. And every man that has this hope, the Bible says, purifies himself even as he is pure. What is the Bible telling us? That we need to set our houses in order. We purify ourselves from things that we know that are weights and sins that are easily besetting us. And I want to tell you this morning that we are not here to speak to Brother Frase. We have spoken to him on numerous occasions. He doesn't need to be preached to this morning. The question is, or the person who comes into full view is you and I. How are we living? How are we going about our daily lives? How are we treating individuals who are around us? Are we pleasing the Lord? Amen. The Bible says every man who has this hope, he purifies himself. Remember that we have an appointment with death. The Bible says it is appointed unto men once to die. You don't die 3 and 4 times, you die once. Once to die according to this flesh, and after that is judgment. How will you stand before the Lord? Well, I don't care. We have to care. How are we going to stand before the Lord? Are you going to stand before a loving Savior or a frowning judge? How are you going to stand before the Lord? The rich will die, the poor will die, the educated will die, the dropouts and doctors, lawyers and magistrates, we will all die. The day will come when we will stand before the Lord. We can run, but we can't hide. And I told some people recently, for the last 3 weeks, having funerals upon funerals. This is the third funeral, and every week we're having a funeral here. Every week. Consecutively. What is it telling us? That life is not what we think it is. Today you are here, and tomorrow you are gone. You're healthy and strong, looking vibrant and robust, but death has a way of creeping up on individuals. While we are alive, we must make our calling and our election sure. Nobody knows the time or the appointed time when we are going to be called of the Lord. For a living dog, the Bible says, is better than a dead lion. King of the jungle, as great as he is, when he lies on that ground and he's dead, and as we say in local parlance, a potong could come and just lift his leg. That's how sad it is. Because in the grave there is no decisions to be made. The living know that they will die, but the dead knows nothing. The Bible says, for the living know that he will die. Neither have they any more reward, for the memory of them is what? Forgotten. They have no reward of this life anymore. If you owe the brother any money and nobody knew about it, that's dead. Unless you come and say, you know, I had $10,000 for him. If you don't say anything, that's it. There is no more reward. There is no settling of arguments. There is no settling of debts. That's it. When you die, that's the end of it. You cannot settle anything after that. But while you're alive, you have the opportunity to set things right. Am I correct about it? You can set things right. The living know that they are going to die. We know everything else. We sit, we make accommodations for everything else, but for debt we don't. We plan to buy cars, we plan to buy houses, we plan vacations, we plan everything else, but we don't plan for debt. And yet when we die, everything is in a mess. We didn't put anything in place. We don't know who owns the house. We don't know who's going to get the car. We don't know who's going to get the $1 million. We don't know nothing because nothing was put in place. And it's important, the Bible tells us, that the living has knowledge that death is coming at some point in time. I know it is customary amongst a lot of people where they don't put anything in place. Put your house in order. Put your house in order. If that is not done, when daddy or mommy dies, it's chaos. The car was mine, the house was mine, no, the piece of land is mine, rushing for everything. We need to set our house in order. And because we know that the living will die, the Bible says our approach to life must be different, friends and brethren. No one is going to turn to stone in this life. If you live long enough, you tell yourself, if I stay around long enough, I'll turn to stone. They will never get what I have. You keep on thinking. It will not happen.
That's not how life is. We seem to have this philosophy that if we hold on to things long enough, nobody will get it. That we'll end up dying, being the owner. As soon as you die, they're changing him. You're no longer the owner. The most you might get on that thing, on that stone, is that you were the founder. But you have gone on now. Nobody's transacting business with you anymore. While you're alive, now is the time to make, amen, the proper decisions. The living know that he's going to die. Amen, somebody. You see, without giving over our stuffs, glory to God, and giving up ownership, we hold on to stuff. I always tell people in funeral services, give the young man what he has to get. Give the young lady what she has to get. And stop holding on to it. You is 99. You can't drive. You can barely see. Release the stuff. I know somebody right now, and this is serious. I know somebody right now, she has 2 and 3 cars. And her son, who wants one of the cars that his father left for him, she will not release it. She will pack it up and wash it down every weekend. And she changes one, she drives that one. She changes that one, she drives that one. Release. Give it up. Allow it to move on. Let the prosperity of your family, amen, look healthy. Release stuff. Let it go. The fact of the matter is, friends and brethren, things are not going to stay in our hands. All of us have to let it go. For a man's life is not consistent in the abundance of things that he possesses. Amen. We have to release it at some point in time. And if we don't, the fact of the matter is we hoard and we keep it. When we die, people we don't like will drive it. People we don't appreciate are going to sleep in it. They're going to wear it. So if you have any say right now, release, begin to put things in place. Am I right? The Bible says in Psalm 49, verse 16 and 17, don't be afraid when a man becomes rich, when the glory of his house is increased. For when he dies, he will do what? He will carry nothing away with him. His glory shall not descend after him. You can be as rich as Donald Trump. When you die, you cannot carry a cent with you. Heard a story, I don't know if it was fictitious or not, but they say this guy, he said, when I die, bury me with all my money. When he died, his wife wrote him a check. She put it in the casket for him to go with. Where he's going, I hope the banks are open. When you die, you will carry nothing. It will not descend after you. All that we have in this life is for here. Let us eat, drink, and be merry. The Bible says God has given to us to enjoy this miserable life. What are you saying, Bishop? I'm saying that while you're alive, take yourself out. Go do your hair, do your nails, eat the best, drink the best, live in the best. Don't live in a shanty old house leaking and falling apart and you have millions in the bank. Are you serious? This life is not going to last very long. It only seems long. 69 and 70 seems long. It's not long. Some of us can remember when we were in school. Now you are 45. It's not long. So you put things in place now. Enjoy what you have to enjoy now. Go on your vacation now. I always want to go to the Bahamas. But you're only traveling to Sando and San Fernando Hill. And you're not going any further. Why? Because it's cheaper. No, take yourself out. Spend the money. Use it wisely. Because the day will come when you will not be able to do it. And then we will have regrets. Because you're lying on a bed of affliction. And nobody wants to carry you. Because you're too heavy to lift up. While you can move, enjoy life. Somebody say, enjoy it now. The time is coming when we will not be able to do it. We will not be able to drive that big fancy car. We will not be able to drive in that beautiful red vehicle, that shiny car. We will not be able to do it. No, you can't do it. Put gas in it. Put on tires and hit the road. Hit the road. Amen. Live life to the fullest. Soon you will not be able to do it. You will not be able to care for all the stuff that you love now. Right now you have the time. Do it. Do it. Amen. Release what you have to release. Give the son the land. Give your daughter the land. Amen. I'm not giving it up. I want all the land for myself. You can't even pull the weeds by your foot. You can't bend. Release it. 1 Timothy 6 and 7 says, for we brought nothing into this world, and we will carry nothing out when we are going. It's strange. Yet we know all of that. Yet we behave as if, well, it's all mine. If you live to yourself, you will die to yourself. Don't push everybody away. Bishop, you don't know the kind of family I have. You don't know the kind of children I have. It don't matter. It don't matter. There must be somebody that can be close to you. You can't be that bad that nobody wants to be close to you. We brought nothing, we'll carry nothing out. As I close, it might be easy to say, I'm not giving nobody nothing. I work hard for what I have. I suffer and I bruise up all my hand. Everything is mine. If people wait long enough, you still cannot go with it. Just have to give you time. You go dead, all of us will die. You will have to leave it. So don't allow that to happen. Embrace your family. Am I speaking the truth? Embrace people around you. Bring in your grandson. Release stuff. Begin to bless him. Don't let him wait till he reaches your age where you suffer the rest, most of your life, and to say, well, I suffer, so he ought to suffer. No. Release. Naked we came into this world, and naked we will go out. Ecclesiastes 5, 15 and 16. We are going just as we came. Don't die with your boots on, people. Don't die with your boots on. Don't die with your guns on your waist and your breastplate on. Don't die fighting. Take it easy. Relax. Begin to release. Begin to love again. Begin to care again. Somebody say, care again. Care again. Begin to love again. Call up family members and tell them that you're sorry and reconnect the family. You don't know what you do me. It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. I will hate them till I'm dead. You will die. But you don't have to hate till you die. It can be solved by one phone call. I'm sorry. I'm coming over to see you now. And they are wondering, I wonder if she's coming to quarrel. No, I'm not coming to quarrel. I'm coming to make peace. Let us make peace while we are alive. Because when we die, we cannot make peace. And the person you leave behind, you will leave them with sorrow and a broken heart. With these few words today, I want to ask us to stand. I know that it is somewhat customary for me to ask you, is anybody here that does not know Jesus? Of course there is. But if you're here today and you have not made it right with the Lord, you can do so now. But what I want to do at this time is ask the family members to come close. Just come around. We want to pray for you. Children, the grandchildren, if you're a brother or sister, just come up close by the coffin. We want to pray for you as a family. We want to pray for you as a family. One of the speakers who came up earlier said, the family that prays together does stay together. These are the days that we need to call up one another and say, well, I just called to pray with you. I just called to see how your day going. Those of you that are on the inside, could you just stretch your hands? Let us pray for them. Let's just agree together. We are praying for their strength. We are praying for God to keep them in a way that only He alone can. Father, we bring this family before you. Lord, on this day, we who have not lost a loved one, but who are friends who are on the outside, we do not know how they feel. But in their hearts, God, their pain and their sorrow, you understand. You know what they're dealing with. You know how they're dealing with it. And so we pray for them. A prayer of strength, a prayer of consolation, a prayer that will keep them in the midst of this situation. And we who are here today, we are not what they call spectators. God, those who showed up today showed up because they care. And God, we ask, oh God, that as they gather together and hold hands and connect with one another and join and bump shoulders to one another, that they will feel the love of those who are present here today. Lord, keep them. Watch over them. Preserve them. May this family be one, Father God, that out of it will be birthed individuals of reputable positions in this life. They will become strong. They will become family members who are going to positively impact this family in the name of Jesus. And we ask, oh God, that even as they console one another and be there for one another, that God, you will be that shield and that buckler for them, that you will be their strong tower, their pillar of strength. Bind them together as a bundle of stick that cannot easily be broken. Lord, your word declared two is better than one, but three, a threefold cord is not easily broken. And so we bless this family. Somebody say, bless them, Lord. We bless this family today, and we ask, oh God, as only you alone can, keep them in perfect peace. In Jesus' awesome and mighty name, with thanksgiving we pray, and we say amen. Amen. Praise God. We ask them to go back to their seats. We want to ask that the hymn, "As the Deer Panted for the Water," and we want to ask Brother Joshua, just this is the where we receive congregational offering at this time. Brother Joshua, just to get the offering basket for us, please, as we receive a congregational offering. We're going to all stand if you can. We want to sing, "As the Deer Panted for the Water." It's on your sheet. "So my soul longed for thee, you alone are my heart's desire, and I long to worship thee." Amen. So we're going to ask you to stand as we sing that hymn today in Jesus' name.
Amen. Praise the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. "As the deer panted for the water, so my soul longs after thee. You alone are my heart's desire, and I long to worship you. As the deer, as the deer panted for the water, so my soul longs after you. You alone are my heart's desire, and I long to worship you. You spirit
Blessed be your name,
Hallelujah.
Jesus.
Thank you.
Praise God. Just have a seat for 1 minute, please. We want to have a special scripture to be read by Jonathan and, is it Joseph?
Joseph. I'm sorry. Ramkisun, could you please come now?
Hi, good morning. I read in Psalm 121. I will lift up my eyes to the hills. From whence comes my help? My help comes from the Lord, who made heaven and earth. He will not allow your foot to be moved. He who keeps you will not slumber. Behold, he who keeps Israel shall neither slumber nor sleep.
The Lord is your keeper. The Lord is your shield at your right hand. The sun shall not strike by day, nor the night, nor the moon by the night. The Lord shall preserve you from all evil. He shall preserve your soul. The Lord shall preserve your going out and coming in from this time forth and even forevermore. Amen.
Thank you so much. Come on, give them a hand. Give them a hand. So we'll do the committal of the body afterwards. We'll do that at the crematorium, but at this time we're going to call back Pastor Charles, who's going to come and lead us in this song, The Goodness of God, and I think there's another song she would be singing. And after that, we will seek to wrap up.
Hallelujah.
Bless the Lord.
Praise the name Hallelujah. Of Jesus. There is a song Sister Nicole had requested, and I'm going to try and do it for you. We give God praise. We give him honor. We give him all of the glory. And you know, even when I spoke to her this morning, she reflected the words of the song. She said, I can make it. And you know, this song is just to let you know and the other family members know that you all can make it. Hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. You can make it through the storm. You can make it through the rain. You can make it through the trials. Make it through the pain. And though you may not understand, there's a purpose, there's a plan. So while you worship, he'll bring you through it all. You can make it through the storm. You can make it through the rain. You can make it through the trials. Make it through the pain. And though you may not understand, there's a purpose, there's a plan. So while you worship, he'll bring you through it all. The rain won't last forever. The sun will shine again, and you'll make it through just knowing that he is your friend. The storm will make you stronger. It drives you through your knees, and only in his presence can the answer be seen? You can make it through the storm. You can make it through the rain. You can make it through the trials. Make it through the pain. And though you may not understand, there's a purpose, there's a plan. So while you worship, he'll bring you through it all. The rain won't last forever. The sun will shine again. And you make it through just knowing that he is your friend. The storm will make you stronger. It drives you through your knees. And only when you worship can his glory be seen. You can make it through the storm. Make it through the rain. You can make it through the trials. Make it through the pain. And though you may not understand, there's a purpose, there's a plan. So while you worship, he'll bring you through it all. And though you may not understand, There's a purpose. There surely is a plan. So while you worship, he'll bring you through it all. Hallelujah.
Praise the name of the Lord. Hallelujah.
Praise the name of Jesus. You can stand and help us with this one.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. It's the goodness of God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
I love
you, Lord. For your mercy never fails me. And all my days I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. In all my life, you have been faithful.
Yes, you have.
And all my life, you have been so, so good. With every of the goodness of God. I love your voice. You have led me through the fire. In darkest night, you were close like no other. I've known you as a father. I've known you as a friend, and I have lived in the goodness of God
all my life.
Cause all my life you have been faithful. Yes, you have. And all my life you have been so, so the goodness of God.
Sing was all my life. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. And all my life you have been
faithful.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oh yes, you have. And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I will of the goodness of God.
I will sing
of the goodness of God.
I will sing
of the goodness of God.
I will sing
of the goodness of God.
Hallelujah. To your name.
Yes, I will sing of the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. Amen. Praise God. Can we put our hands again one more time for the Lord? Right. Next, the bearers of the coffin. Are we going to have a viewing before we leave? All right. Could you please, at this time, we want to, I was going to call back the singers so we can continue singing that song one more time. We're going to have a final viewing, and we're going to have to get out of here by a certain time, all right? So we would ask, please, if you are just a visitor, you're a friend or so, if you can pass file, just file pass. all right, and have a view, but please leave time for the family to have that opportunity to be at the coffin, all right? So we want to sing that song one more time, and we're going to have that viewing at this time.
All my life you have been faithful. Oh yes you have. And all my life you have been so, so good.
Just before you continue with your beautiful singing, we have the condolence book in the back there that the family had asked. If you can, please kindly sign. Alright, it's right in the back there. You get some instructions. God bless you. Thank you.
All my life you have been faithful. Yes, you have. And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. Your voice, your mercy never fails me, and all my days I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. Yeah. And all my life you have been faithful. Oh, yes, you have. And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God.
I love your voice.
And you have led me through the fire. In darkest times, you were close like no other. I've known you as a father. I've known you as a friend. And I have lived in the goodness of God. And all my life you have been faithful. Oh yes you have. And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am I will sing of the goodness of God.
All my life.
And all my life you have been faithful. And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am of the goodness of God.
Yes, I will sing
of the goodness of God. Oh, I will sing of the goodness of God.
All my life.
And all my life you have been faithful. And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God.
Oh, I will sing
of the goodness of God. Oh, I will sing of the goodness of God.
All my life.
In all my life you have been faithful. In all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God.
Oh,
I will sing of the goodness of God.
Yes,
oh, I will sing of the goodness of God.
Oh, I will sing of the goodness
of God.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Bless the name, Jesus.